In case you missed it, Google's team, the DeepMind team to be exact, has once again taken the world, the internet by storm as they released a paper titled Assessing Game Balance with AlphaZero, Exploring Different Rule Sets to Chess. Now, we at Chess.com were super fortunate that the DeepMind crew reached out to us more than a month ago now and actually gave us a sneak peek into this paper, as well as answering a lot of our questions in terms of why they did this, what they believe the most important high-level takeaways were, and just generally have been awesome working with us to help develop and prepare the content that you're about to see. We have several videos coming to our YouTube channel and the greater worldwide web that is chess.com over the coming week, and this video here is going to break down what exactly were the most important takeaways of DeepMind's report. What is Danny's top 10 list of all of the different variants they tried, including not just the pros and the cons, but maybe my thoughts on whether a particular variant could ever really gain traction with the traditional chess community. And then we're going to give you the rules and even suggest a way that you might be able to try some of them yourself at the end of the video. So don't go anywhere. It's time to jump in and give you that TLDR, since not everyone's going to have time to read the full paper. What did we learn from the latest of the AlphaZero project? Here we go. And so without any further ado, let's meet these variants and try to learn the rules to these new games. Here they are in front of your very eyes, taken directly from the Assessing Game Balance with AlphaZero report. Right at the top, no surprise, Vladimir Kramnik has been championing no castles for a while. A couple different versions of that were tried. Again, I'm going to break down all of these and explain what I think the pros and cons are when I rank them coming up here in the video. This is just designed to give you a quick snapshot in terms of what the nine variants were. The 10th, by the way, was just classical chess. Pawns moving one square, stalemate equals win. Torpedo led to some really interesting tactics. I'm going to break down those in a future video. Pawns moving backward and sideways were also super insightful and interesting in terms of different ways we might view chess positions. And then self-capture, which is also, of course, one of the potentially very interesting things to consider about the future of chess. What exactly did all of these variants give us in terms of stats? Well, the high-level view is that each one of these games increased the amount of potential decisive results a little bit, besides maybe one that shouldn't surprise you. Pawns moving backward, if anything, actually led to even more peaceful results. Right in the middle, you can see the torpedo variant as one of the ones that would really be a champion for those who are just maybe obsessed with the idea that we have to find a way to get some more decisive results. But this is a different view just to show you, take out that graph for those who aren't into the green, red, and yellow pretty colors. This was kind of the quick snapshot in terms of what we got. So classical chess right there at the top is actually interesting because you learned that classical chess actually still had a higher potentially decisive result than some of the variants, particularly, as we said, pawns moving backwards, which made it even harder to lose positions. And no castling before move 10 actually didn't necessarily lead to more decisive results. Now, if you look at some of the ones like torpedo, right, you see a massive increase, a 5% increase right there at 56.8 over 51.8. Stalemate equaling a win was also something that, no surprise, would increase the amount of decisive results. In some ways, the takeaway of the DeepMind team having discussed with them was a little bit surprising to them that it didn't lead to even more potential decisive results. But I'm going to give my thoughts on that both in a future fully focused video on all the different chess X's and O's that would come from making stalemate equal a win, as well as just talk a little bit more about the potential pros and cons of that when I do my ranking of all these variants at the end of this video. We also had some interesting kind of crazy stats that were revealed when they pushed the computers to play different openings, right? So it wasn't just that they adjusted the rules, but actually made them play openings that are considered a little bit dubious, right, at the high levels of the game. The Dutch defense, looking at that actually having an even bigger increase on potentially decisive results, as well as the Chigorin over there. The pawns moving sideways in the Chigorin is enough to give you kind of a panic attack in terms of maybe too many decisive results. Let's remember, looking at the pawns moving sideways or the pawns moving backwards, different stats, if we go back to the classical one, just to remind you in terms of what exactly you're seeing here, we didn't see the same type of percentage increase, right, as we do when they play absolutely wild openings. They also had them try the Al-Yohin's defense as well as the King's Gambit, and again, led to a lot more crazy stats, including Black getting a lot of W's in these variants in the King's Gambit. No surprise, the King's Gambit itself maybe has work to do both in classical and in some of these crazy AlphaZero variants. if it's ever going to be seen again at the highest levels of chess. So with that, we've taken a quick look into exactly what was the variant. That was the quick high-level view in terms of what the report did to change the stats. More decisive results, some more draws, maybe some surprising things. But without any further ado, and for some of you who maybe have already checked out the chess.com news report, seen some detail, I'm going to give you my top 10 in terms of what I actually think is the chance of these variants getting a hold and getting some traction in the chess community, as well as give you what I think is the biggest maybe fail of this report. And that's obviously not calling out anybody at the DeepMind, the think tank over there, but more like from a classical chess point of view and some of the variants that are already featured in the chess community, what do I wish they had actually done in this report? We'll talk about that at the end of my top 10 list. But without any further ado, let's jump in with number 10. In reverse order, it should be no surprise that the variant that gets us the least excited and actually led to some of the most boring results was pawns moving one square. Hard to really think of why we even did this one. Honestly, I think one of the most important advancements to the game was allowing pawns to move two squares, accelerating aggressive play and opening theory, all this stuff. So I guess if anything, at least it gave us the pro of affirming our previously held beliefs that pawns moving one square doesn't seem like a great idea. So I would say both the pro and the con of this is that it was boring, not necessarily something that surprised us, and logical thinking ahead of time should have probably told us this. At the same time, it's nice to see AlphaZero confirming for us that we don't want to go backwards to having pawns move only one square at a time. Let's go to number 9. Number 9 to me is the semi-torpedo game. Now, not the full torpedo and the crazy tactics that, as I said, I'm going to show in a different video, but going a little bit there, you get to see pawns moving twice, not just on the second rank, but on the third rank, or of course, respectively, the seventh and the sixth rank for black. Adds a little more spice, some unique tactics, but overall, I would say while the pro is there, like torpedo, it adds a little bit of excitement. The con is, why not just go all the way to torpedo? And with that, let's go to number 8. In my mind, number 8 is torpedo. Now, despite the fact that I've said many times it has some of the best tactics, I would also say that it's a little bit unintuitive. So pro, exciting, different, something that is really special about it are positions that might otherwise be losing. You have weird defensive mechanisms. We're going to talk about that in the other video. But the con, I would say, is that it's kind of hard to grasp. When you start to actually see it in motion, you can actually play it over at chess.com/variants. Oops, spoiler, I was supposed to wait till the end of the video to tell you that. I found it a little bit unintuitive to anticipate some of the things that could happen on the board. So maybe with more time, I would rank torpedo a little higher than number 8 on my list. But remember, this list is not just my favorite variants, but also the ones I think have the best shot of really actually not only becoming more popular online, maybe they eventually become popular in serious tournament play. So let's keep moving down this list from number 8 and go to number 7. Sticking with the pawns, I found the sideways pawn moves to be the 7th most exciting, even more so than the torpedo and the semi-torpedo, because while the pawns move more aggressively forward, it doesn't change the nature of chess really in a harsh way like the sideways pawns one could have done. You'll see some really interesting tactics, but while I would rank the tactical ideas as part of the pro, I would say the con is that it actually changes some of the long-term strategic nature that humans approach the game with, in that double pawns are never permanent. You can undouble them anytime, right? Open files aren't necessarily the same that you would think of them. They could be closed or reopened again, kind of at will. So like torpedo, there's some unintuitive stuff there, or at least counterintuitive, but also super interesting and definitely one that you should consider giving a try as we launch it over at chess.com/variants. On to number 6, I ranked pawns moving backwards as the 6th most interesting, and again, potentially could maybe someday be a part of traditional chess in terms of the variants we all like to play. The reason I say that is because pawns moving backwards to me was more conceptually intuitive, in that it allowed you to go for plans knowing you could fix and undo weaknesses. If you expanded your space too far, maybe you could take your foot off the gas and back up, not just one, but maybe multiple steps along the way, right? We joke that chess.com bugs sometimes when you open up your king and wish you could move the pawn back later on. You could do that when it comes to backward pawn chess. And I found it, the whole concept, just intriguing, mainly from a defensive standpoint, how it would change our ability to be more aggressive or less aggressive in spots. Again, like all the pawn variants, I would say the con is, again, not super intuitive. Again, no fixed weaknesses. Does change the way we look at a lot of chess variants. That would be a worry for me and a kind of a con of it ever really taking hold of the chess community. But pawns moving backwards is certainly interesting and one really, really cool tactic I'm going to show in the later video. Now it's time to break and do our top five. No surprise, we start with Kramnik's favorites, the no castling in back-to-back order. I'm going to start with the fifth place going to no castling before move 10 because, well, it's a very intriguing idea to remove castling from the game, keeping the kings in the center, allowing more flank weapons to develop in terms of opening theory. It's also very close to traditional chess, so it doesn't totally rock all of the giants currently dominating our game. They could get into it. But I look at the biggest con of no castling before move 10 is why not just go all the way to number 4? Number 4, no castling at all. I think it's super interesting. I've already played it against Vladimir Kramnik on a stream some months ago. Maybe we'll link that for you in the video in case you happen to miss that stream. And I think that he makes a very good point that as far as one of the variants that could easily be implemented, no castling is certainly one of them. The reason it didn't even make my top three, though, is because when we saw AlphaZero really duke it out against another AlphaZero, it didn't increase the decisive results enough to really get my fancy going, right? I felt that it was not something that if we're going to really change the game and eliminate a lot of opening theory, looking for something that we justify it as the whole idea is to make it more aggressive, keep the king in the center, make it harder to defend, and it doesn't bring the decisive results up enough. It just didn't quite have enough firepower behind it to make the top three. Now, number three is a weird one because it's actually my favorite. That is the self-capture variant. It adds so many interesting dimensions to the game, both from attacking and defensive ideas. Again, you're going to want to check out the later video where I show what some of those really interesting tactics were in these head-to-head AlphaZero battles that the team at DeepMind did. But I agree with Vladimir Kramnik, who said that this might be just an improved version of regular chess. Again, so many different things you would look at differently if you could capture your own pieces from both aggressive and defensive ideas. And while it is my favorite, I had to have integrity in the list here. It's my personal favorite, but again, the criteria was not just did we enjoy the variant, was it interesting, but also what are the chances it could immediately take hold of the game? So we've got two left after the third self-capture. Classical chess, because there were 10 played, and stalemate equals a win. Well, obviously we would think that number two should be stalemate equaling a win, because how could we ever overthrow a top 10 list by saying that classical chess is not the best? Well, guess what? You're wrong. Number two to me is classical chess. I believe so strongly that stalemate equaling a win is such a good idea that we should really consider how quickly we implement that into chess. And I know you're going to say I'm crazy. The video that I have coming your way shows so many interesting concepts, things that would change in the way we evaluate approach, end games, and middle games, our approach to the strength of the opponent we're playing, our ability to think we could force a dry position or not. There's so many pros also conceptually in terms of explaining our game to new people that chess is one of the hardest things to understand and that there can be a tie that is never broken, not even with overtime or sudden death or a shootout in hockey or a penalty kickoff in soccer. You can't fix the draw in chess unless you really eliminate stalemate, which doesn't even really eliminate the potential for a draw, i.e. positions like king versus king. But I rolled right pass number two into number one precisely because there was no real other twist ending to add to it. Classical chess is the same as it always has been. The greatest game on any board ever in history. It's the game of kings. I love it. I've dedicated my life to it. But I strongly believe stalemate equaling a win might not only help grow the game to beginner players and eliminate some confusion that is stalemate versus checkmate, but actually could make an impact in terms of the decisive results as we saw. And I would argue that the decisive results we saw in the stats column here with the AlphaZero team would actually be even higher if it was humans, because AlphaZero being AlphaZero makes it even harder to get a win. Even with stalemate, the computers are perfect. But I think there's so many things we do as humans conceptually when we're defending worse positions, relying on the potential of stalemate, that if we made that change, we might see real positive return for our hard work there. So anyway, I can't wait to hear your comments. I know there's going to be some controversy down low. Go ahead and leave a comment for us. Please hit that subscribe button and let us know what you think. Am I crazy? Should stalemate equal a win? Make sure you check out all of our future videos where we break down the best chess positions and interesting tactics from the report. And with that, I'll leave my final note on what I feel the biggest failing of this report was, is while all of the variants I showed and the rules I explained were interesting, I don't understand why the team didn't have AlphaZero battle it out in some variants that have already gained a lot of traction within our communities. Fischer Random Chess, we've had a world championship of it, right? What happens if AlphaZero is throwing down there consistently? What about things like Crazy House, Bug House, right? King of the Hill, 3-check, variants you can already play at chess.com. I don't know exactly what it was that had them steer away from variants that have already gained traction, and maybe one of them will answer our question. We're hoping to do a round table kind of session, and we might dive into some of that. But leave a comment down low and let me know if you agree with me that seemed to be a bit of a failing, or to me, just kind of a miss in terms of if we're going to have this resource of AlphaZero and try to unlock what some future variants of chess could be, why not focus on some ones that already have piqued our interest. So with that, signing off here with the breakdown, the TLDR of this amazing report by DeepMind and the AlphaZero crew, and look for more videos coming your way soon with awesome chess X's and O's on the board.